I'm also very glad that I was picked to speak in this panel in particular. First of all, because it's people-centric, so it's nice to think about the humane side of issues sometimes. And also because, you know, when I was at the Ministry of Finance, that was one of the key challenges that I faced, how to enhance welfare at one point while not increasing budget deficits and at the same time trying to maintain a sustainable fiscal position. So that was a heavy toll, and especially during, you know, the pressing social needs that we faced and are still facing even more profoundly than before. Obviously, I'm not unique in this respect. This has become a huge policy debate around the globe, especially after the 2008 financial crisis, and even after the worst effects of the crisis have subsided. This has presented itself as a central policy debate among emerging and developing countries around the world. And as you all know, policy advice for the last two decades has mainly focused on maintaining financial and monetary stability, with the social issues taking a somewhat secondary role in budget discussions and formulations. However, and even the IMF has reached that conclusion, sound macroeconomic conditions and environment obviously have proven to be not enough to ward off crisis or to address the huge social and developmental and economic demands of countries. So it is no longer, I want to say, blasphemy to talk about increasing public expenditures, especially social expenditures or even investment expenditures, at the expense of increasing fiscal deficits, but assuming that financial and monetary stability is not jeopardized. This is becoming more mainstream and more acceptable by economists and policymakers around the world. And as I said, I think this is a rhetoric that is being repeated by most of the institutions that advocated otherwise. And even it has become a more acceptable discussion among policymakers across the economic ideological spectrum. Maybe 4 or 5 years ago, even the title of that panel would have sounded, would have appeared to have an underlying tones of, you know, leftist policies or whatever. But today, I think everybody is embracing that concept and that theme, and it's no longer just you know, a certain ideological category that is thinking about the social dimensions of fiscal policy. Here, if I may, I would like to talk a bit about Lebanon. And as you know, Lebanon has, in the early 1990s, as it emerged from a long cycle of violence, it was faced with the huge task of restoring the role of the state, of enhancing social services, of enhancing security, of addressing significant economic and physical infrastructure needs. So with very, very limited resources, we ran large fiscal deficits to meet these huge social and fiscal infrastructure demands. On one point, we ended up succeeding in building our country, our economy, while maintaining financial and monetary stability, albeit at a very high fiscal cost. However, we failed to, I believe, realize the full potential of the social benefits that were commensurate with the huge outlays that we undertook to enhance welfare. And I think our biggest problem was that in times of growth, especially in the late, actually in between 2007 and 2010, even when we had growth, we failed to make this growth balanced, and we failed to make this growth job creating and you know, that is shared by all sections of the society. Nowadays, though, this reality has even become more dire, if I may say. We're talking about social services in the absolute context. This is not the case for Lebanon, because We are now faced with an influx of Syrian refugees, around 1.5 million of Syrian refugees versus a country of 4.5 million. So almost maybe towards the end of the year, we'll have 50% of the population of a different constitution than the original one. So this is a huge, huge, huge social problem. I don't think any country in the world has faced such a burden as the ones we are facing. I know Turkey and Jordan have accepted a lot of the refugees and have opened their borders for the refugees, but in terms of relative terms, I think our challenge is much harder than the rest of the neighboring countries. The problem also with regards to the influx of the Syrian refugees is that these Syrian refugees have received a lot of assistance from a lot of the international community. Not enough, obviously, but much more than the host community itself. And this has created a lot of tension, social tension from the Lebanese themselves, because they see that they have opened their arms to receive all of these Syrian refugees. We don't have camps. They've been dispersed throughout the Lebanese territory, and they're receiving all of this assistance, while the Lebanese themselves, who have opened their arms to welcome these people, have not received anything. So it has created a lot of social tension, and frankly, I don't see, short of receiving a lot of assistance and support from the international community, I don't see how this situation can be resolved. And it has political ramifications, and we can see that, I don't want to talk politics, but there is a lot of political ramifications to this situation. One thing, though, that has happened is that I think the fact that the host community has now become much more demanding of social services because of what they see in terms of the Syrians, the government has become more cognizant of these demands, and has now started to, with the help of the World Bank and with other donors, to provide some sort of targeted assistance to the host communities, those communities who are receiving the majority of these Syrian refugees. So now we're using the mechanism that has been developed by the World Bank, which is the poverty targeting mechanism. And hopefully this mechanism, which has been in the process of development for the last 4 years, now is well conceived, so that we can identify the people or the portion of the population that is most negatively affected, to start giving some money to these people. So our expectations are very tame or very modest. What we care about in Lebanon is to maintain a stable status quo. And maybe that would sound a bit defeatist, but frankly, the challenges are so big and so gigantic, that the best thing for us to do today is try to maintain some sort of a social cohesion, social balance, and a monetary stability in order for us to be able to sustain the next 2 or 3 years, hopefully not further. And that's why, when I made the comment about the central bank and the relationship between the banking sector and the treasury, obviously, I'm not advocating that this is the right thing, the high exposure to the treasury, to the private sector, to the treasury, is not something that obviously is acceptable in economics 101. But for Lebanon, a bad thing has turned into a good thing, at least in times of crisis, where we see that this relationship has at least allowed the Lebanese economy to maintain some sort of stability in its exchange rate regime. This issue of inclusive and balanced growth, obviously, is something that also Arab countries have faced. And we see from the uprisings that occurred in the last 3-4 years that the root causes were mostly social and economic in nature. And so when we're talking about social expenditures and social spending, we don't only talk about it in economic terms, but also because it has political ramifications. And I believe unless the economic and social needs of these countries by the new Arab regimes are addressed either through structural reforms or through equitable growth or through providing for the social services that they need, I think the political stability will remain in jeopardy. But if I want to talk a bit more about the subject of our panel today, I think it's important to, and here I'm talking theoretically because I don't have the luxury to talk from my own experience, but at least from the readings that I was able to do, I know that social spending is not important in terms of its magnitude, but in terms of the outcome it yields. So, and from that angle, it is also important for any government to try to translate these social expenditures into specific indicators and objectives, and to try to put these social indicators and objectives in a certain macroeconomic or medium-term fiscal framework. Because if you don't do that, you're going to be subjected to a lot of political interferences, if I may put it this way. And if you take a medium-term approach to all of these social targets and indicators, at least you try to safeguard these social indicators and outcomes from any kind of political interest and from changing political agendas. And here we're only talking about the spending side, but we, and fiscal policy, obviously, in terms of also enhancing welfare, we have to talk about the revenue side. And as you all know, especially after the Thomas Piketty book and the increasing disparities in income and wealth that is taking place in developing countries, you know, a lot of people, economists, are now calling for increases in taxes, the income tax structure, or also reducing the tax expenditures, the deductions and exemptions and so forth. Obviously, these voices, you're hearing them much more than before, and picking this kind of debate is picking ground. On the other hand, there are more the more liberal voices are questioning this policy, and this debate you're seeing gaining ground, especially in France and in the U.S. And I think the jury is still out on this kind of debate. What is the proper policy mix, fiscal policy mix to be adopted? I think this kind of discussion will be with us for the foreseeable future. In summary, I think this is a delicate balance that governments have to strike between maintaining enhancing welfare of their population and at the same time maintaining a sustainable fiscal position. And this, to a large extent, will have to depend on the specificities, the economic conditions, developmental conditions of each country. What is good for Lebanon in a crisis situation is not necessarily good for Tunisia now that it is on a much promising path. So there are no standard policies or no standard recipes for any of our countries. Each country is passing through its own difficulties, through its own crisis, through its own stage of development, and therefore it's always good for multilateral institutions or policymakers to take into account the stage or the conditions, economic conditions of each country. Just to wrap up very quickly, whatever policy mix one policymakers adopt, I think it is important not to forget the private sector role in social welfare. And it is important to, first of all, delineate between the role of the private sector and the public sector in the provision of social services. also beyond being just the engine of growth, and in our country it is the main engine of growth, the private sector can also provide a comparative advantage sometimes in the provision of social welfare. So this has to be also taken into account. And as I said, given the budget constraints that most governments face, it has become extremely important to be outcome-oriented when discussing welfare. Budget policy must not be measured only by the magnitude, but by the result it yields. Therefore, it is important from the outset to identify measurable milestones and intended targets. And lastly, I believe decision makers must adopt an appropriate tax policy that does not stifle private sector growth while at the same time generating enough revenues to finance all the social demands of each country. Thank you.